To round out our series today on vascular stabilization in retina health and disease, we've invited Dr. Caroline Baumal, Dr. Carl Chalky, and Dr. William Lee to participate in a panel discussion. Dr. Baumal is a professor of ophthalmology at New England Eye Center, Tufts Medical Center in Boston, Mass., where she specializes in medical and surgical disorders of the retina and vitreous. She's authored over 165 publications and 28 textbook chapters. She's actively involved in research and teaching at New England Eye Center. Dr. Chalky is the Chief Executive Officer and Chief Medical Officer for the Retina Foundation of the Southwest in Dallas and the T. Boone Pickens Director for Clinical Center of Innovation for Macular Degeneration. Dr. Chalky has also published over 135 papers and textbook chapters. Dr. Lee is the CEO and co-founder of the Angiogenesis Foundation, where he leads national and international efforts to develop new therapeutic strategies for disease involving the microvasculature, including retinopathy. Dr. Lee has authored more than 100 publications, including a New York Times bestseller. So let's get started here. I've asked the panel's permission to be a little informal here and address them by their first names, but let's see where we can get started. Let's start out first with, how is vascular stability or instability assessed in the clinic? Carl or Caroline, is that something you want to take a shot at?
Sure. Well, vascular stability and our ability to even treat vessels really started with the anti-VEGF era. Before that, we were really limited in what we could do to modify vascular diseases in the eye. We had laser. And then in the last two decades, we've had really two things, an explosion in our ability to do high-level imaging of the retina, going along with high-level pharmacology and new therapeutics. So when I'm in the clinic and I want to explore vascular stability, in addition to my examination, which I still do, I really rely heavily on imaging. I'm able to use things like OCT. I use OCT angiography, which is helpful to look for presence or absence of flow. And I can combine this with dye-based angiography to look for dynamics of vascular flow, things like leakage and additional information about non-perfusion. And I'm able to put that all together and make a picture. And then we have
Caroline, can I stop you for 1 second? Tell me, sure. OCT. I'm not exactly sure what that stands for. Tell me about OCT imaging.
Well, OCT stands for optical coherence tomography. Mm-hmm. And when I started my fellowship, I don't want to necessarily give away the year of that, but okay, well, it was 1995. When I came to Boston from Tufts to do a fellowship at Tufts, that was actually when OCT or optical coherence tomography was being developed with the prototype OCT. And what's so innovative is OCT gives us cross-sectional images of the retina with details approaching that of which what we would see with histopathologic sectioning. So it's almost like an in vivo optical biopsy. And it's one of the things that really sets us apart in retina from so many other areas in medicine, that we can use OCT and get amazing high level structural information of the retina. And by using OCT, we were able to refine on our clinical examination. Actually, we became better doctors, better examiners and treaters of the retina. So when the treatments that came through, which were anti-VEGF therapies, we could use OCT to really numerically quantify the effect of anti-VEGF therapies. So it was really like something that took us to the next level in retina. So that's how, you know, I like to use my exam, my imaging, and then I use the current medications I have to assess for vascular stability. If I see that I'm dealing with an entity such as diabetic macular edema and the retina is thickened and swollen, and I treat the eye with anti-VEGF therapy or steroids, and I see that the clinical process improves, then, you know, I am assuming that I'm improving vascular stability, that I'm positively affecting and reducing the negative cytokines that are in the eye causing the negative effects.
So the OCT gives you the ability to actually determine whether your interventions are actually working or not.
Correct.
And the only thing that I would add, I was going to add to that discussion, Caroline obviously has beautifully outlined what we do, but I do think it's critical to understand that when we, you know, think about vascular stability, there's really kind of two components, right? There's this idea of permeability and leakage, right? And that's one component of a destabilized vessel. But of course, the other aspect is, of course, rekindling or trying to get the vessel stable. So I think the interesting thing is that we've appreciated the fact that there needs to be a component by which we are actually disease modifying, which meaning we're trying to reverse the instability, making vessels more stable. And ultimately the readout of that is going to be durability. And that is the idea that if you can reestablish stability, then the intervals between treatments should start to prolong, because we've essentially disease modified, meaning we've established a stability.
Let me ask real quick, Carl, then are you relying though on imaging tools to determine whether blood vessels are unstable, or are there other ways that a clinician can observe evidence that these blood vessels are unstable other than OCT, for example?
No, so right now, you know, it's very interesting when Caroline was talking about the advent of OCT, it really kind of married with the advent of anti-VEGF. So what we're seeing now is we're still reliant on OCT as an indicator of stability. And this duration that we are talking about typically is measured by looking at OCT, changes in OCT over time. What I think is going to be really interesting is as we get into a better understanding of true disease modification and stability, will newer technologies that we don't have yet fully measure this kind of more stable concept of stability and you know, where the vessel, the stabilization is actually can be measured in some quantitative way?
Yeah, well, I mean, the paradigm of actually disease treating pathology versus disease modification is actually an incredibly important one. And as somebody who works at internal medicine and looks at another facet of vascularization, which would be in chronic wounds, where we actually have wounds that are not healing, blood vessels are trying to grow, but if they are abnormal and are unable to sprout and develop normally, in other words, sort of regain physiological function, what winds up happening is you wind up having a bed of these leaky blood vessels. And what's interesting is that there's a tool that originated in ophthalmology, indocyanine green imaging, that's now used by surgeons to look for these leaky, abnormal, structurally unstable vessels. And we know when we see that the vessels are unstable, and we know when we modify the disease with wound therapies, we know that the vessels then become stable, the leak remits, and then we actually have a more physiological state. So I think that everything Caroline and Carl were saying is seen in other areas of medicine as well.
Hmm. So Caroline, this growth factor VEGF that we've been talking about, of course, is one of the most highly studied molecules, not just in general, but also, of course, in retinopathy. And its role, as you said, has led to a better understanding of both neovascular age-related macular degeneration, as well as diabetic macular edema. How does the role of angiopoietin 2, Ang2, and its overexpression in retinopathy, how does that help us better understand retinal health and disease from a clinician's perspective?
Sure. Well, I think that as Carl and William have talked about, we have this treatment paradigm, this anti-VEGF OCT treatment paradigm, and we've come a long way, but the story's just too simple. And we know other cytokines that are involved in inflammation and disease states. And the angiopoietin pathway is a high likelihood hit in these disease states. And I really think this concept of vascular stability is actually new for us in ophthalmology. It's not new in other fields, like William was saying, in wound healing and other things, but it's new for us because we just haven't been able to have vascular stability or regrowth of vessels, even something like that. That would be like a new concept for us. So there are three things that I think really support the role of the angiopoietin pathway in some of the diseases that we see commonly in the retina. And that's really basic science information that we have using animal models, using in vitro models, and then also looking at the science, looking at, for example, cytokines in the vitreous of people who have diabetic retinopathy and neovascular AMD. And all of these models, and there's multiple of them, they all support this role of the angiopoietin Tie-2 pathway playing a role in vascular stability, and not just by itself. I mean, we see elevated VEGF in these diseases. We see elevated Ang-2, which is the bad player, which is the negative factor. But we also see this really complicated synergistic role between VEGF and Ang-2, where the effects of Ang-2 potentiate the negative effects of VEGF. So I think that is a really important thing to know. And it's probably we're just at the tip of the iceberg understanding that. But I always have to say to myself, Ang-1 is the vascular stabilizer, that is the good player, if you want to call it, and Ang-2, which in pathogenic states, it's released and it displaces Ang-1 from the Tie-2 receptor, and Ang-2 leads to the negative effect. So Ang-2 and VEGF are like the bad guys. So that just always helps me clarify it in a simple way before I go into the complexity of the situation.
And the only thing that I would add to that discussion is, you know, the observations that we've made, and to Caroline's point, that in some ways, because the anti-VEGFs were relatively effective at reducing the fluid and in some cases improving vision. At the same time, we also found this enormous kind of variability in patients' response, right? And in their need for anti-VEGFs. We've now known that for the last almost 15 years, that we have patients who are exquisitely sensitive to anti-VEGFs. We have other patients whether it's in diabetic retinopathy or neovascular AMD, we see a similar kind of wide kind of response to our therapies. So we already had a hint that there was obviously additional factors that were at play because of these observations that we had made in the clinic using a single agent anti-VEGF. So there's clearly additional factors that are playing a role in these patients that we treat.
So, Carl, is it fair to say then we had a fairly simplistic look at these retinal diseases having to do with VEGF and treating it with anti-VEGF, and now we're getting to know that some of these other cytokines, we've got good actors and bad actors, and that may help explain the differences in responses to anti-VEGF. Will, I think you alluded to it a little bit earlier, but let's dig into it a little bit deeper. Are there some other examples of vascular structure and function, not just in ophthalmology, but in other medical specialties where vascular instability contributes to disease? We'll let you talk about the others, and we'll have Carl and Caroline talk about ophthalmology.
Sure. I mean, I'll give you a couple of examples outside of ophthalmology. But before I do that, I want to maybe give a little context to what Caroline and Carl were just talking about, which is sure. The process of blood vessel growth is really complex. It is like a symphony orchestra. And I think for us as clinicians, what we're really trying to do is to make sure that the music is being played in a way that's actually melodious and acceptable. What happens when there's one or two growth factors that are going out of sync or playing too loud, and we're beginning to think that, you know, maybe VEGF was just the horns, and now we're beginning to realize there's some other instruments like the drums that are playing too loud. What we're really trying to do is not to say they're good guys, they're bad guys, but it's almost a volume effect. It's too loud or coming at the wrong time. And so what we're really trying to do is to have the understanding of actually how the music is actually created to be able to better modify a disease back into the harmony that the body really wants. Now, we see this in other areas of disharmony. For example, in pediatrics, we will see vascular instability in a disease called hemangiomas. This is pretty common in babies with these little cherry marks that are born, and they're blood vessels that are growing out of control without smooth muscle, with endothelial cells that are dilated. And they're like little mini aneurysms that are more vascular malformations. That's a whole other dimension. We also see that in the brain with arterial venous malformations. Structural abnormalities that can grow in the brain, and those can lead to aneurysms. And as I mentioned before, in venous leg ulcers, you actually have, rather than blood vessels sprouting perfectly to heal the wound under the scab, you wind up having blood vessels that form more like kidney glomeruli. These are abnormal, weird, twisted ends of vessels that don't function normally. And so this idea of getting the orchestra to play the piece in the right time, in the right moment, with the right combination of growth factors and modifiers is really, I think, what we're all striving to do.
So you were going to give us a couple of examples. Are there any beyond those that you just mentioned where you've got this vascular instability contributes to disease?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think that, you know, the pediatric condition, the venous malformation, I will also tell you that tumors, cancers, which have also been the focal point for anti-neovascularization or anti-angiogenesis, and also targeting VEGF, has now we're now realizing that some tumors are highly vascular, but the vessels that are there are completely abnormal. Like in glioblastoma, it's a great example of that. And we're seeing heterogeneity as well, where other cancers also have a lot of blood vessels that are abnormal, but less abnormal than, for example, in the brain. And so this idea that different diseases will manifest in different ways and in between different individuals really allows us to begin appreciating the subtlety of disease, so that we're not just, you know, being the hammer and everything's a nail. We're beginning to actually have a much better appreciation of the fine points of stability.
Yeah, that's what I was going for. Good. Thank you. Carl or Caroline, do you want to talk a little bit more about how this structure and function plays into ophthalmology and retinal diseases? We've talked a lot about it, but is there more that we should know about?
Well, there are other diseases that we know have this similar kind of instability, and the vein occlusions are by far the next most common set of diseases that we see, these central and branch retinal vein occlusions, where there are either temporary or permanent occlusions that occur. And then, of course, downstream from that or upstream, these vessels become unstable and there's permeability increases. So that's another set of diseases that we typically treat as well now with anti-VEGFs alone. And in many cases, they're equally responsive, but also in some cases, they're not as responsive. And similar to other diseases, there's a whole mixture of responses and how often they need to be retreated. So that's probably the next set of common diseases that we see that have this similar kind of vessel instability motif.
There's a few, maybe retinopathy of prematurity is another disorder that we know certainly is related to elevated VEGF. So there may be a vascular instability component to that. And there may be a role of the angiopoietin type 2 pathway in that. And then I think that we have other disorders that are retinovascular diseases that may have a potential role for the angiopoietin type 2 pathway, sickle cell retinopathy, other things where we see abnormal blood vessels in the eye and it's not really clear what the etiology is. So time will tell. And then, you know, Carl, there's also macular ischemia that we sometimes see in diabetics. And it's unclear whether something this has the concept of vascular stability. Could that play a role in negating or inhibiting progression of macular ischemia that we see in diabetics? I think that that's yet to be found out.
Yeah, and I think that's a very interesting idea that, you know, when we think of this, and like you pointed out, the Ang2-Ang1 ratios, and the fact that when Ang2 is upregulated, not only can it add and you know, exacerbate excess VEGF effects, but it also can inhibit potentially recanalization, other things that we are needing in certain cases like ischemic retinopathies and so forth. So I think there's, it opens up this idea of the Ang2 pathway and its effect opens up a whole series of, for us, very critical things that we think about in terms of the patients that we treat.
So clearly we are learning a whole lot more about the biology of Ang2 and how it plays into retinal vascular disease. As you guys were talking, it occurred to me, what is the relationship or similarities and differences then between this diabetic retinal edema and some of these other retinal diseases that we've been talking about, particularly macular degenerations? Are they different ends of the same disease process, or are they very different? How would you characterize them?
Well, I think diabetic retinopathy, typically we think about it as there's issues with blood vessel instability in the retina related to hyperglycemia. We typically think that the hyperglycemia affects parasites, which are the supporting system around endothelial cells, and that this leads to diabetic retinopathy with leakage, and then there's vascular shutdown, which leads to ischemia, and then VEGF release, which might not be the only cytokine release. There's probably other things released too, and then this leads to neovascularization and these new blood vessels that are released and that are formed in relation to this ischemia. They're abnormal and pathologic blood vessels. So that's part of the process of diabetic retinopathy. With regards to macular degeneration, I think one of the main differences is the location. Diabetic retinopathy happens in the inner retinal circulation. That seems to be the level of the pathology. It's a little easier to study because we can look at the vitreous, but neovascular macular degeneration or macular neovascularization, it's underneath the retina. So it's not as easy to measure VEGF levels. And certainly ischemia and choroidal blood flow is reduced and may play a role in that. So I think all of those things differentiate these two diseases, but we've been really fortunate in ophthalmology. I mean, I might say anti-VEGFs, that it's like a one-hit thing and that it's a simple way we look at it, but certainly development of anti-VEGFs and the number of people we've been able to treat and reduce blindness from these diseases, it's been a miracle. I mean, really, it was genius. So we're very, very fortunate, but of course we want more for our patients. And we were very lucky, Carl, I mean, don't you think, that we were able to find this one like pathway, anti-VEGF therapy, to treat three big diseases, you know, neovascular AMD, diabetic macular edema and diabetic retinopathy, and retinal vein occlusion macular edema. I mean, we're so fortunate that one thing worked for all three, because they do differ when you look at the vitreous levels of VEGF that are secreted in these conditions.
Yeah, I mean, we in that sense, you're absolutely right. I mean, it was for us in ophthalmology, it revolutionized the way we treated our patients. As Caroline said, you know, the interesting thing about diabetic retinopathy is, again, the pathology, site of the pathology, and even the mechanisms of the pathology are fundamentally different. And so it's going to be very interesting to see as we start to explore the Ang2, Ang1 ratios and modifying those, what effect it will have preferentially on diabetic retinopathy, where we know these parasite involvement is such a critical feature or dysfunction. And we know that the Ang1 synthesis from the parasites and that ratio is an important player. So I think as we start to interrogate Ang2 inhibition, it's going to be very interesting to see if we do see some disparate effects preferentially in diabetic retinopathy. Now, having said that, in neovascular AMD, as Caroline said, it's a completely different pathology, different site of location. It's true new vessel formation, which is really more of a scar. And I think one of the things that excites us about the Ang2 pathway there is, again, trying to stabilize these vessels, at the same time trying to enhance the anti-VEGF effect and improving the durability. Because for us, and particularly with neovascular AMD, while we've been fortunate, at the same time, it's, you know, caused us to have to treat these patients frequently, have they all have to come back. And that is a real stress on the system, on the patients, on their caregivers, and us as well. So I think for multiple reasons, I think at the same time, we are in desperate need of additional therapies to improve our care.
Another dimension that I think is worth pointing out is the role of inflammation in neovascularization, which often goes hand in hand, but not necessarily in every disease at the same level. But what's really interesting is to think that that actually inhibition of Ang2 at the experimental setting actually lowers inflammation, and inflammatory cells themselves are depots for many other growth factors. And so just by being able to actually impede inflammation by modifying the angiopoietin pathway may also give us some additional leverage on some of these processes, including scar formation.
Yeah, you know, William, I think that that's a really important point. And we know that also if we give inhibit VEGF, and if we give, for example, an intraocular steroid, that can have an additive effect. But the issue is that intraocular steroids also do not have a lot of durability. There are some types that you can use for longer durability now from slow release sustained delivery devices, but there are some side effects associated with intraocular steroids that we prefer to avoid. So certainly inhibiting inflammation by, you know, there's multiple pathways that we could do it. We know that has an additive effect. And I would say that both of you bring up an important point that the angiopoietin tie 2 pathway has been shown to be involved in so many basic and in vitro models affecting parasites, you know, showing that the, you know, inhibition of Ang2 increases parasite coverage. The pathway, the Ang1, Ang2 pathway has been shown in so many preclinical and basic science models to play a role. For example, that when Ang2 is inhibited, there's improved parasite coverage. And Ang2 has a negative effect on endothelial cell tight junctions. And Ang2 increases inflammation. It increases leukocyte migration, which leads to this, you know, circle of inflammation with more leukocytes being recruited. And Ang2 also increases fibrosis. So there's so many models that support the role of Ang2 in vascular instability, and inhibition of Ang2 leads to vascular stability.
So it sounds like that vascular permeability, as we know, is a normal physiological process, though, but it has to be balanced in homeostasis, right? So what are some considerations that we ought to be thinking about for ocular health in terms of vascular instability and this vascular stabilization that we're saying is so important to control these pathologies. So as we wrap up our panel tonight, I always like to ask our panelists for a pearl of wisdom, a little nugget, golden nugget to take home for our viewers on this webinar. Caroline, I guess ladies first, can you, what do you want to make sure people remember from what we've been discussing tonight?
I think that the term vascular stability is going to play a role and be very important when we consider new therapeutics for the retina. In the past, we had maybe regression of neovascularization. We had treatment of ischemia with laser, but vascular stability is sort of a new way for us to think about things. And inhibition of Ang2 can play a synergistic effect with inhibition of VEGF to lead to vascular stability. That's my takeaway.
Well, I'm going to give you the final word here, because as the head of the Angiogenesis Foundation, it must be very satisfying to see some of what you've been working on for so long really kind of come to fruition and really start to make some true or have some true clinical benefit. And I also love your metaphor of the symphony orchestra having to play together, because I happen to know of your interest in, maybe not in symphony orchestra and rock music, I know, of your interest in that. What would you like us to take home from this?
Well, I've been working in the angiogenesis field, both as a vascular biologist and also as a clinician for more than 20 years. And I will say that back in 1998, at a conference in Europe, there was a proposal that I made, which was that one day we would be able to inhibit angiogenesis on one hand for a certain group of diseases, which would include the eye. And on the other hand, we'd be able to grow blood vessels to restore vessels where they're needed for healing, as an example. But there was a third angle, which was to stabilize and get normal vessels right in the center. So that was a third leg of the stool for the approach to vascular health. And so what I want people to leave with is that, you know, we need to aim for physiology and not just pathology. And our ability to start to tease out the role of the angiopoietin-Thai pathway, along with our other understanding of VEGF and other vascular control mediators, starts to give us that tool.
I want to thank all of our panelists for truly an educational evening and some fascinating ways to look at, as we say, pathology and hopefully physiology, particularly when it comes to diseases of the eye. So thank you all for imparting your knowledge to us, and we hope that this will make a difference to everyone who's been viewing. Thanks again.
Thanks so much, Max.
Thank you.
You bet.
Thank you.